Hello and welcome to How to Win the Lottery, Season 2, Episode 3, The Art of Fielding by Chad Harbach. I'm Joey Lewandowski.
What up, Joey Lewandowski?
I got nothing. Where do I go from here?
I don't know. How are you? Let's start with that. Let's do the thing that I love when podcast hosts do, which is like when they don't get into the shit that they're supposed to talk about for a while and they just catch up on mic.
Since I hung out with you yesterday and today, I think you know how I am because everything, it's been good.
Joey got into a fight yesterday.
No, I didn't. I
don't. He some.
The, I admonished a younger man.
We were at a concert and two people were talking, and Joey got up in this guy's shit, and I saw out of the corner of my eye. He just started waving his hands in the guy's face, and then the guy sort of panicked and ran away. Like I heard a little whisper where it sounded like Joey like said something like, "I will bust you open like a fucking pinata."
And you leaned over, you're like, "What's that all about?" And I'm like, "Don't worry about it, I'll tell you later." You're like, "Do I have to do karate?" And I'm like, "I don't know, maybe."
Yeah, it was cool. It was cool.
How are you?
I have a big announcement that maybe I should save for the Patreon.
Uh-oh.
I'll just say it here. No more wrist pain, baby. All gone.
That is a Patreon exclusive.
If you've been following the Patreon saga of me having pain in my wrist for the last 5 months, 4 months, whatever that is.
Did you make Dylan send you the big-breasted woman?
Anime?
Yeah.
Anime boobs? No. He didn't send it. That's cool. It just, you know, it's just a matter of not...
Not jerking off.
Oh, god damn. Don't eat. You know my penis doesn't work, Joey. You bring all this on, Mike. I guess I did it to myself by saying, "Let's not talk about the book. Let's talk about my personal issues."
Bob, what is The Art of Fielding about?
That's a really good question, because I think that like there is a surface level plot thing going on that says it's ostensibly a book about baseball.
Yep.
and
at a fictional Midwestern college.
Yeah, baseball at a fictional Midwestern college. And then there is a secondary one that is about like what it means to be a leader, what it means when prodigious talent abandons you, what it means to come to terms with growing up, what it means to relive a second adolescence, all of those things.
Sure.
What was your favorite part?
My favorite part?
Yeah, pick one of those and we'll...
Oh, I was, oh, pick one of those things you said. My favorite part was the baseball.
It was?
Yeah.
Okay.
We talked about this. Spoiler. I'm going to read in advance Egg's disclaimer at the top of her email. "I feel the need to have a disclaimer before I begin my email. I did talk a little bit with Bobby about the book, but the following is all of my ideas."
Oh, I'm Bobby Fisher, by the way. I didn't introduce myself.
That's Bobby Fisher. I want to add on my own disclaimer that we talked en route to that concert where I almost scuffled with a youngin about this. And I think what I really love about this book is the baseball. It feels like Chad Harbach not only likes baseball, but loves baseball, has probably played baseball, has been around the sport, is appreciative of the sport, is able to talk eloquently about the sport, is able to make it to capture the beauty of baseball in writing in a way that someone who was not either as skilled a writer or like passionate about baseball, if you don't have both those things, it's going to fall flat in one way.
And I think, I also think that there is a marriage of baseball and like high literature that doesn't exist for other sports. Really. There are a lot more good baseball novels than other kinds of sports books. And I think part of that is because the single-mindedness, the poetry, the tension and release of baseball is simply a much, much more poetic game than other sports are.
True. What was your favorite part of The Art of Fielding?
The baseball.
Yeah?
Yeah. To the point where, like, for a book that is as long as it is...
It's over 500 pages.
I wish that baseball had made up a more significant portion of the plot.
Because it's so good.
Yeah.
My issue with the book is that the first half, it's not as clean as this, but the first half is kind of baseball. And the second half is not baseball. In the end, baseball comes back.
Yeah.
But when it devolves or strays into not baseball, it's, I don't know, worse, but different.
When it becomes Affenlight and Pella's narrative. Yeah.
Because the novel centers around five characters. I guess kind of four and a half. I don't know if Owen really is kind of, I guess if Owen counts, it's five. Mm-hmm. We got Henry Scrimshander, who is a shortstop. And a prodigious talent who who has to be molded into a prospect for Major League Baseball.
Arguably the book's main character. Certainly the character that sets everything in motion at least twice, if you could argue that there are two inciting incidents in the book.
Sure. And he is molded by Mike Schwartz, mm-hmm. who is a senior, the catcher on the baseball team. Well, I guess by the end he's a senior, but he's a year older than Henry. Old and wise beyond his years.
Yeah, he's a leader. He shapes the world around him to make it into what he wants through the exclusive force of his will.
And that is similarly, in different ways, but similarly captured by Gwert Aphenlight, the president of the university, the college.
Yeah.
Who is a 60-some-odd-year-old man whose wife died?
She died.
Right? And then his daughter, Pella, divorces her husband, or separates from her husband.
Just runs away. Yeah.
Runs away. Who, a much older man that she met when she was in high school or something.
She was in high school.
And he was like 30.
Yeah. And in like a weird way, this book is about predation with never really saying that it's about predation.
Sure. Yeah.
Right. Like the predatory stuff in this book is sort of astroturfed. Or maybe astroturfed is not paved over. So that you can like enjoy the book without it being a novel about predation.
Right.
But like, if you really like look at it, you're just like, yeah, there's a lot of power dynamics here that are not healthy.
Because the other thing is that, you know, Pella spends a lot of time comparing her husband, David, to her father. And sure, her father winds up doing exactly what David did. Not exactly, but very close.
Yeah. What's the major difference?
Gay stuff.
Yeah. Major difference is that he is an adult man who is seduced by a college age student.
Yep.
And Pella was a high school girl who was seduced by a college age, maybe a little older than college.
I think he was like 30. I think he was 30.
College age man.
And they talk about that a little bit, about like at the end when it comes to light that Gwert is having this affair with Owen. If it was a woman, he's thinking, if it was a woman, a female student, I would still be in trouble, but they'd be like pouring themselves scotches.
Well, they're of two minds on it, right? Because like part of him thinks that this is okay because it's a man.
Aphenlight thinks it's okay.
Yeah, I mean, he says that like earlier in the book, because it's a man, it doesn't seem as predatory because like he's, I don't know. It's hard.
He also seems like he's being taken advantage of.
Right, because he's the naive.
His entire life he's been heterosexual.
Yeah, he's a novice to the idea of, let's call it, Socratic love. And so, because I think that fits with the theme of who Gwert is.
Sure.
And so he falls in love with Owen, who is Henry's roommate.
Mm-hmm.
Owen is an experienced gay man.
Yeah.
And so, and also Owen, because of his demeanor and stuff, feels aloof, feels...
But like aloof in a positive way.
Yeah, right.
Or at least not in a negative way. In a confident...
Right. Nothing affects him. He's calm.
His nickname is Buddha.
Yeah, he's a balm to everyone around him. They look to him to guide them. He doesn't get angry. He's a relaxing presence.
One of my favorite moments with that is when Owen... And we're jumping all over the place, and we'll get back to where we're talking about. But when Owen and Mike go to Owen and Henry's room, and it's pretty clear that Henry and Pella had just had sex.
Yeah.
And Mike's like, so Owen, you forget to make your bed today? And he's just like, guess it's possible. And then Mike finds her underwear and just like, these yours too? And he's just like, probably not. It's just like, he tries to be so like, don't take sides.
Yeah.
And then just like, I can't get out of this one. It's just like such a kind of a low key.
So Owen being the experienced, the more experienced lover, yep. I guess, though still 22-year-old, 21-year-old, is in some ways like the guider of the relationship with Aphenlight, who's having his first gay experience. But at the same time, like, and also is like guiding Aphenlight toward a more environmentally friendly policy with the university.
Yep.
So he's like influencing all these things the way that would indicate that the power dynamics are not what they are.
Yes. I really, really, really like this book a lot, but in this conversation already, I'm realizing that I'm frustrated by how many threads were started and not dived into.
Like what?
Well, so like they touch on the fact that Owen is white, both white and black, uh-huh. and they don't really dive into like the meaning, the implications of that, like the environmental stuff. Like it just feels like there are things that like the book could have either been shorter or longer.
Yeah, there's basically zero racial politics in the book, which is interesting.
It feels kind of like a big deal.
For being about athletics, like baseball, arguably the most diverse sport.
I don't know if that's true anymore.
This is a conversation that I've had before. I think we think of things as diversity, like the NBA is more diverse because there's less white people in it. And like the NBA right. is a majority black league. But baseball has...
more
white people, sure. Latinos.
That was the weirdest way you could possibly say that word.
Because I was gonna say I was gonna do the like progressive thing of dropping the of making it a gender neutral noun, but then
it's all boys.
I was like, yeah, it's all
because like the team is largely white, but Izzy is Hispanic.
Yeah,
and Owen is black.
And then there's a Indian kid on the team, okay. AJ.
Okay.
Go out of their way to point out that sure. it's a diverse group. But at an elite liberal university that is probably majority white, like sure. that one.
But it is interesting going back to the like length and the things, they don't touch on that. But like they make a big deal about, to a certain extent, that he is not just white and that his mother is black.
Yeah.
It's not explored, really.
I think it's a super light book. I think it's a like very breezy beach read book yeah. that doesn't go deep on things. It's not dark really, although it like faints toward darkness a little bit with Henry's depression stuff.
But by the end, he's okay.
Exactly. Yeah, he comes back around. He may have re-entered a toxic relationship with Mike.
Oh, 100% he did.
But that toxic relationship might be what's best for him.
So we have the characters. We talked about Henry. We talked about Mike. Talked about Affenlight. Affenlight's daughter, Pella. Mm-hmm. We briefly touched on, but comes back because she's like, I need a new direction in life. I'm thinking of enrolling here, much to the joy of her father, who wants nothing more than to be close to his daughter. And then there's Owen. Those are like the five main
characters. Yeah, the five main characters, right? And so Henry, in a bit of Owen Meany.
This is Owen Meany light.
An errant throw strikes Owen
yeah.
in the face.
Right.
When he's in the dugout, Henry, who never makes a mistake ever, like it to the point where he is, when he makes the mistake, he has just tied the record for games in a row at the NCAA level without an error.
The Art of Fielding, the title also refers to a book in this world called The Art of Fielding, written by, I guess, like an Ozzie Smith sort of stand-in.
Yeah. Aparicio Rodriguez.
Yes. Shortstop for the Cardinals, who is a defensive wizard. And wrote this like Zen and the Art of Baseball kind of book called The Art of Fielding that Henry's obsessed with.
Yeah, which book seems to propose that the shortstop controls the game because the shortstop is the center of the baseball universe. He controls the action on the field. He controls the vibes
yeah.
of the game. Like the stillness comes from him. If a shortstop is panicking, if a shortstop is making errors, then the team will fail. But if a shortstop is assured of himself and makes the plays poetically and treats the game like poetry, then the team will succeed, which we see is the case, because once Henry shows up on the team, they play significantly better than they ever have before.
And he does, in the Owen Meany sense, seem to be sort of touched by God in a way that he has like a supernatural ability to understand. There's part of that just innate, but also like he works harder at it, right? Because he's undersized and he's not necessarily a natural athlete, but he's right. smart. He knows where the ball is going based on where the pitch is going before the batter even puts the bat on the ball.
Yeah, I mean, this is what, you know, I think we talked a little bit about this, but when I was watching The Last Dance, the Michael Jordan thing, yep. they're, like, interviewing Dennis Rodman,
yep.
who, like, people think is, like, a total bonehead and, like, a moron because he has, like, green hair and piercings and stuff. But, like, when they were talking to him, he's like, oh, yeah, I, like, memorized the shot of every player in the league, and I knew that, like, the spin that they put on, I knew every different player's spin that they put on the ball, and I could calculate that spin and the angle of the shot, how it like bounces off the glass, so I could make those rebounds. And it's like, oh yeah, Dennis Rodman presents as this like dumb jock, but he's actually like one of the greatest rebounders of all time. And to be the greatest of all time at literally anything, you actually have to be really, really, really smart.
In an interesting way, Dennis Rodman is kind of split into Henry and Mike, right? Because Mike is he presents as the dumb jock.
Yeah.
But he's very, his goal, like he wants to go to law school, which he does not get into, but he's a sage and a coach and like literate and well-read. And then Henry has the, you know, computer brain kind of, but also like the natural grace.
Let's talk about this. Who is the book's main character?
I don't know.
I think it can't be Henry, because Henry doesn't do shit.
And he's also not a cipher for the audience. Like, he's not like, oh, we're on the team or whatever. Like, if it was told from, like,
right.
another character's point of view, it'd be like, oh, okay, like, that's, we're just along
with. Yeah, he's a prodigious talent who, during this inciting incident where he beans Owen in the face, loses his ability to throw to first base.
Yes.
Right? In a condition called the yips, or Steve Sachs' disease, I think they call it.
I think so.
And there's a number of players who, over the course
Chuck
of
Knobloch, baseball Rick Ankiel, yep.
history, they've lost the ability to throw.
Yep.
Whether it be a catcher throwing back to the pitcher or a shortstop being unable to throw to.
Yeah, Knobloch could not throw from second base to first. Rick Ankiel could not pitch anymore. He could just, like, throw wide.
Yeah.
That's another thing I like about this book, is that it takes actual baseball history and applies it to this fictional world.
Right. This psychological breakdown that happens in this college, but, like, also very much happens in real life.
Yeah.
The yips is a real thing. It just happens to people.
What you were saying is scary.
It's terrifying to me. This idea that you could, like, one day just lose something that you were so good at. I mean, it's similar to the way that, like, psychotic breaks are scary. Like you wake up and one day it's like, oh, reality is different, and I can no longer, like, see the world the same way that other people see the world, and I need to be hospitalized for that.
Yep.
That's, like, a terrifying thing to me.
The book is basically told not first person point of view, but, like, sort of third person point of view, third person omniscient, or whatever.
Close third
from, like, the four main mm-hmm. not really Owen as much, but the other four characters are kind of like the focus of different chapters, yeah. right? And when we're in Henry's head, sort of, kind of, I do think that the way that Harbach writes him, like, pumping and, like, re-gripping and gripping and grip, like, feels real. Like, it feels like,
yeah.
it feels well-written.
Absolutely. And like, you could make an argument for Henry being the main character based on that, and that, like, emotionally, the weight of the novel seems to fall on him. I'm way more emotionally invested in what's going on with Henry than I am in what's going on with Athenlight.
So sometimes, and I don't think this book nails it in a way that other things, but, like, sometimes when there's multiple characters, like, the best kind of things that bounce back and forth, every time it moves to a different character, you're like, I want more of that last guy or whatever.
Yeah.
But then you're like, oh, but I also want to know what's going on with this new guy. But, like, go to Athenlight, I'm just like, I don't dislike it, but it's I think inherently less interesting.
Hey, part of it is that Athenlight story, and they talk about this in the book, is something that we've seen a million times.
Yeah.
Right? Like, they're, like, albeit the, like, kind of gay twist on it, but, like, he talks about it. He's like teachers sleeping with their students is, like, the second great topic of literature, and the first great topic is just infidelity.
Yep.
Right? So it's like that, when we move toward that, it's like, this is kind of old hat. It's wearing a pretty outfit, because it's, like,
sort of more modern, more woke, whatever.
Yeah. Arguably maybe less woke. It's all stuff that you've seen before, right? Like, yeah. Like, maybe the difference is that there's no, like, you never feel like it's evil. You never, like... Like, I didn't think about Athenlight, like, this guy's doing a bad thing.
He's genial. He's likable. And I think because we're in his head,
yeah.
it's sort of, we know why. We sort of know how he feels.
And because he is the novice. Because he's someone who's just, like, you know, he's nervous about it.
It would be interesting if we were in Owen's head, what he actually thought, like, if he was always enamored. Because he said, by the end, he kind of seems like, oh, I've always, whatever. But, like, I don't know if that's true or not, or if he's just saying that. You know what I mean? Like, at Athenlight's sort of, like, second obituary or second, you know,
yeah, burial beautiful. Or whatever. It's beautiful, but you do, like, throughout, you've sort of gotten the sense that Owen is just like, yeah, this is like a fling.
Right.
He's going to Tokyo. He might not come back if he... I mean, he has no reason to come back because he'll be graduated.
Although it does seem like if it was just a fling, what eventually leads to... I don't want to say Athenlight's a downfall, but, like, what leads to him getting caught, they go on a date. And they yeah. go to a motel, and then they come back.
Because right? Owen is like, you never take me out. Like, we can't be
yes.
a couple.
Which is...
So we have to leave town and go to a motel or whatever.
Which is, I think, if it was just a fling, he wouldn't have put that effort in, I think.
Which also, though, by the way, is another cliche. Like, that is, like, a cliche of infidelity literature. This idea, like, oh, you always keep me...
Right.
Chained up, and we never get to go out, and then when they finally do go out, they get caught because they needed to be public.
What is interesting and unique and then never addressed again about that affair, well, actually, too, so I want to go back to the Owen thing. If we were in Owen's head, I think we might think less of Athenlight.
Maybe.
Because I think he'd be like, oh, he's just like this creepy old guy. Like, I'm just trying to, like, sleep with, like, hot young college guys, and, yeah. like, this guy's like always around or whatever. And like, I like him and he's smart, but like,
yeah, you're not clued into the vibe that's being given off of his own personal innocence.
Yes. Another thing about the different perspectives is that I feel like they're all kind of written similarly.
Okay.
Do you agree or you not agree?
I don't think there's like a great difference in voice. I think the biggest attempt at difference in voice is Owen. Owen's voice rings false to me.
But Owen's also not like a main character.
Right.
But what I think is interesting, the nice sort of twist on the affair subplot, that again is not addressed again, that Henry's mom is the one who finds them.
Yeah, which is, you have to understand that as a reader. It's not written out for you. It doesn't explicitly say that
it's Henry's mom. It's mentioned once, and then that's it.
But even when it's mentioned, it's not explicitly said that it's Henry's mom.
Right, no.
It's just like, it happened to be a motel, and you know that Henry's parents were in town that week.
Well, no, because they say a parent.
And that the student's not on the team anymore.
Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, it could be theoretically somebody else, but like, it's Henry. Right. But they never say it's Mrs. Scrimshander.
Yeah, yeah. And you rewind then to her concern that Henry has a gay roommate.
Yeah.
In the beginning, when she's like, do you think maybe you
want to switch rooms?
Yeah. Well, like, what's that about? We're not hateful people, but.
I think that's interesting. I think that's a nice payoff that is just not addressed, really.
No, I like it like that. I like that it's like,
I know.
I like that it's just trusting the reader to make to draw out whatever conclusions they want.
But a similar sort of thing that I feel could have been explored more, but maybe not, maybe it's better this way, is that like, I think Henry's sister is a great character, or a very interesting character. I think their dynamic is good, and she's in the very beginning, and she's in one scene toward the middle end, and that's it.
Yeah, I don't know.
Did you like their dynamic?
I did, and I liked her being in town, and I liked her getting drunk and making out with Starblind, and her being like this dramatic fulcrum on which we have to like rest this idea of Henry going missing on the night that she's around, she's in town, and then she disappears and she never comes back.
She's a 17-year-old high school student who doesn't live close. Like, they have to drive pretty far to get there.
Wants to party,
right? And I understand that, like, there's not a real organic way that she could just fit into the narrative, but also,
if this were a TV show, she would be guest star twice. Next season, she would be a freshman at the college and become part of the main cast.
Yeah. But
which is why it's good that things like this aren't TV shows.
Do you think, would it be better if it was adapted? Because did you read the wiki?
No.
You look so scared.
I stand a fear of your judgment.
I think they tried to adapt it twice and it just didn't work. And I don't know why. Like, there's not like a huge.
Yeah, it seems like it would be fairly straightforward.
Do you think it'd be better as a movie or a TV show? Like, is the question.
A simple movie. You don't need to. Like, a sports narrative really only works as a movie.
What about our upcoming comedy series, The Pen?
Oh, Pen 15.
No, not that.
No, I know.
What did you think I was going to say that you were like warning me off?
I thought you were going to try to trip me up by saying Friday Night Lights. And then I was going to have to go into a whole thing about why Friday Night Lights doesn't really work as a sports thing.
Well, because that doesn't really get football right, but that's...
Also it's just like state championship, no state championship, state championship. There's only really like one or two things that can happen.
Hail Mary with 2 minutes left? Okay.
Right, yeah, over and over again, right? Because that's like a small town story. So yes, it has to be a small town story. The same way that this is a small college story.
Yes.
And is not necessarily a sports story because like... Even though it kind of ends at the national championship, that's where the climax is.
Doesn't matter.
The national championship doesn't matter.
Right.
It's not part of like that's not the story. And like what we think is the sports story, which is like the rise of Henry. Let's get back to the conversation about who the main character is. Right. That story gets completely ditched. Right. It's just like it's like, oh, you think this is going to be the thing? Guess what? The sports guy that we've been following, he's not on the team anymore.
Which is interesting. That's a bold move to make.
Yeah. He's no, like, you were so invested in him breaking this record and getting back from his, like it seems like it's going to be a story about him clawing his way back to be able to play baseball again after having his game destroyed by this incident of hitting Owen with the ball. And that doesn't happen. He doesn't get his game back. It's not, I mean, by the end, you can argue that he's trying to get his game back, but it's still not there. We don't know what happens with him.
And what feels strange is we see him spiral into a depression
Yeah.
where he's almost literally not eating.
He's not eating. and he's pissing in cups and leaving them in, yeah, in places, and he's not eating soup. He's leaving the soup.
He's not shaving. He's not showering. He's not going out.
He's bathing.
Well, he's lying in the bathtub.
Oh, was the bathtub not filled with water?
I don't know.
I assumed it was because he was naked.
You could just lie in a bathtub naked.
Yeah, true. We've all done it.
We don't see him get better. Like, that's rushed through. Better, quote unquote, better. Like, his whole, like, therapy thing. Like, we don't follow him to therapy.
He goes to a psychiatrist for bulimia and depression.
The quick background is that Mike is this, you know, very talented, not necessarily the best player on the team, but, like, a very talented baseball player, very talented football player, leader, shaper of men.
Coach.
Who is using his influence to build an athletic program at Westish. So he recruits Henry, blah, 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 whatever. And so by the end, by his senior year, by Henry's junior year, the team actually has a chance to, like, go pretty far. And so that's when Henry, you know, gets the yips, leaves the team, and they continue to win in spite of Henry.
Which is another subversion of whatever sports story we thought we were going to learn.
That's, yes.
Because it seems like, oh, Henry's not there anymore. He's goodbye to all of our chances. But, like, yes, it does that thing. Tom has a name for it. I don't remember what it is, but it's like a thing that happens in sports, which is where the best player on a team leaves and then the team inexplicably gets better.
Yeah.
Because all of a sudden they start playing more like a team and it's no longer focused on that one person, and it becomes like, now we have to survive in spite of this person, so we all have to step our game up. And so Starblind gets better, Izzy gets better, Schwartz, I don't know if Schwartz gets better, but he keeps doing his thing.
He's
leading the league in home runs or whatever.
And so, like, he leaves sort of midway toward the end of the regular season. They make it through all the, you know, regional and conference and finals and whatever. They get a national championship. And then Henry shows up there, right? Yeah. But, like, that's his sort of triumphant return. And that also feels not rushed, but the whole, like, Affenlife dying basically off camera. Like, we see him coughing and, like, having heart palpitations or whatever, but, like,
yeah, well, let's get to that in a bit. But, like, the reason why I don't think that Henry functions as a main character for this story, Henry's actions until the very end when he leans into the pitch don't mean anything to the narrative. Everything is acted upon him. He is full of inaction. I guess the only other action is that he sleeps with Pella. But even that is, like, a function of Pella's own personal depression.
Yep.
He's that guy because the world is acting upon him. He's sure. Not Schwartz is the one that takes him in. He goes to college because of Schwartz. He becomes a good batter because of Schwartz.
He gets in shape because of Schwartz.
Yeah. Like, Schwartz is his guide. So nothing Henry does is because of Henry's own
volition.
Yeah. He doesn't do anything. He's a completely passive character until the very end when he leans into the ball. But that's not enough for me.
But he is the one that, like, connects everything.
Right. He's the inciting incident, right? There are, I guess, two inciting incidents, one being Schwartz's recruitment of Henry and then Henry's hitting Owen in the face with the ball. Because Henry's hitting Owen in the face with the ball also allows Affenlight the excuse to visit Owen in the hospital, which allows him to get close to Owen.
Literally and figuratively.
It also breaks Henry and Schwartz's relationship in a way where Schwartz can no longer really confide in Henry because he doesn't want, like, Henry doesn't function as a friend to Schwartz because Schwartz, like, when Schwartz is going through stuff, he can't tell Henry about it because he's afraid that he's going to, like, mess up his game further. The Schwartz-Pella stuff, like, is, like, a lot of their interactions is, like, a result of Henry's failures. So Henry as a passive character has this widespread influence over the text, but it's not like Henry as a character, it's Henry as an incident that does that,
yeah,
right? On the other hand, Schwartz is a guy that moves, like, almost everything that happens in the text happens because of Schwartz's actions.
Right.
He's the one that pushes everything forward, right? He's the one that recruits Henry, he's the one that, like, changes the entirety of the Westish academic program. He's the one who tries but fails to get into law school, which makes him, like, a depressed person, which sort of puts him in the arms of Pella. He's the one that chases Pella away because of Henry. There's, like, a million things that Schwartz does, but, like, what Schwartz does and doesn't do is the result of action rather than inaction. So, like, I think that Schwartz is the main character of the text because Schwartz is the person that is, like, actually doing stuff.
Schwartz is also easily the best character in the book
Yeah, the most fun.
The most compelling. And I think just one of the better, like, of any of the books that we've read, like the 14 whatever books we've read for this podcast, is just like, he's a really well-written, interesting, fun character.
Power rankings of people that we've read about that you'd want to hang out with. It's like Schwartz is at the, probably number one.
I think Owen would also be fun to hang out with.
Mostly because most of the books that we've read have been like about horrible things happening to people and people who are, you know, I agree that Owen, but Owen could probably be pain in the ass too. What I'd like to see is a Schwartz Owen buddy comedy. Owen Meany?
No, I meant Owen.
Okay.
This Owen.
I thought you were talking about Owen Meany. Is that a new segment?
Who would we hang out with?
Power rankings of hangs.
All right, we're going to, so I'm listening to With Gorley and Russ, and I was saying this to some, maybe to you, I think, but like Matt on his window, like has all like the history of Friday the 13th, like where things happen. Mm-hmm. We got to have like on my wall, like a power ranking of, I'm going to go to Walmart after you leave, and I'm going to buy a whiteboard, and we're going to have a power ranking, and we're going to leave space in between. We're going to have.
I love this. Are you really going to do that?
Yeah, we can do that. And this will be a Patreon bonus episode for next week.
Okay.
Plus the other thing that we can't talk about.
My wristband being better?
No, the thing that we do every week that we're not talking
about. Oh.
The secret.
Yes. Wink.
But yeah, I'm going to buy a whiteboard and we're going to do it. And we're going to have like who the cool characters are.
All right, yeah.
Schwartz is at the top.
Schwartz is at the top. Owen's at the top. Owen Meany's at the top too. Because he's like, how do you not love that guy?
Friendship takes practice.
Yeah.
Because I don't think you could really argue that Pella's not the main. Pella's tangentially, but I think the book is largely. It's not the same, but I think it's largely similar if she's not involved.
Yeah, yeah. I think there is a version of this book where you can cut out all of the Athenlight stuff.
Yes.
Both Pella and Gwert and just make it a baseball book. And it's like 200 pages shorter and maybe better. A stronger book.
I don't want to think about it like this because I like the book and I don't want to think less of the book. But in a way, it feels like Pella is there to give Mike a happy ending.
I think she's also there to have a female character in the book.
But I mean, I get that, but also I don't know that you don't need it.
Yeah, can just be a baseball story.
Because she's also kind of a cliche too. And like, I think they almost admit as much, right? Like mm-hmm. She's the younger woman seduced by an older man, trying to impress her daddy, in love with her dad to a certain extent, like, you know, looking for a guy who like can emblematically replace her father or whatever. And then rebelling against him by choosing the dumb jock in Mike, but then realizing that Mike's actually like her dad. Like,
yeah, he's not dumb at all.
She's a string of cliches.
Greek.
Yeah.
Yeah. I like Pella, though.
I like Pella.
And this is something that we talked... Oh, maybe this was the conversation that I had with Megan, not you. Whereas Prep was a novel that I liked that was entirely full of characters that I didn't like. And so, like, their actions when bad things happened to them, I didn't care necessarily. This book is entirely full of bad things happening to characters that I like.
Yeah.
Right, like every single one of them I like. Although Henry tests my patience a little because it's like he should not sleep with Schwartz's girlfriend.
Even though it leads to one of the better scenes in the book.
What's the better scene?
In the locker room, like asking everybody if they care that he slept with Pella, and they're like,
"Yeah,
no, I guess not."
I like the part where Mike goes. I think Mike asks him or says, "You fucked my girlfriend," and then Henry just goes, "I fuck all your girlfriends," and just like makes no sense at all.
I think that's the same scene. Yes. Sure, Henry. Whatever, man. So I think in terms of the main characters, it's either, I guess it's one of three things, and this is kind of cliche and dumb, but it's either Henry or Mike or just Westish. But I don't think the breadth is wide enough to really be Westish.
I think it's kind of Gwert, too.
Even though you're saying you could cut him out.
I think you could cut him out. You could also cut out the baseball stuff and make it just a Gwert story, but that's like not, yeah, that's a novella and it's not a good one because it's cliche.
Have you ever heard people referred to as fresh persons?
No.
Instead of saying freshman, they say fresh person to be like gender neutral.
Exclusively, they say fresh person.
But it's not just like, it's not like Henry referring to it. It's just like there's like the report, like the local beat reporter's like, oh, this fresh person. It's just like, wait, everybody in this universe says fresh person?
Yeah, it's not something I'd ever heard before. And it's something that just came up in this book. And
here's a question for you. I'm just looking through my notes now. And I don't know that this matters, but it was something that I genuinely didn't know how to read, interpret in the book. Pella is married to David, who is this older man, financially takes care of her, is just like, just do your art, baby. You're a great artist. Do your art. And she's like, I'm trapped. And she runs away.
Yeah.
So then he shows up to Westish, like halfway through the novel, and they go out to dinner. And it's the same night that Gwert and Owen have their date. Gwert was supposed to go with Pella, and he just like abandons her. She's like, no, that's fine. And like kind of just like sour about it, whatever. But David is like don't you remember? We had sex all the time recently. You just didn't remember. Like, I got you these earrings. And, like, is he gaslighting her? Is she actually forgetful? Does it matter? But it feels like we're, like, we're verging down a path of, like, this is a different novel. This is,
like... It's like a postmodern novel about perspective.
Yes. And, again, that's not brought up again.
Yeah. And David completely disappears from the text after that. He doesn't come back at all. I don't even know if anyone ever mentions him again. I believe her, partially because I think that he is clearly a manipulative predator.
Yes.
So, like, in this case, why not just believe her?
Because she also says, like, oh, he always does this. Like, he'll buy me something nice as a way to, like, cover up other things. But he's like, don't you remember when I gave these before? You forgot them at home or whatever. Just like, well. But it feels like a, oh, no, like, the world is, like, crumbling. I mean, I know that it is. But, like, it was effective in a way that the novel didn't do before.
Yeah.
Or after.
Right. Because she's like, oh, we haven't had sex in over a year. And he's like, what are you talking about? We had sex on Christmas Day.
Yeah.
I remember because I gave you this. And then he.
Which is a real weird move. But, I mean, I guess it probably has worked on her in the past, right? So.
I think that's, like, textbook gaslighting.
Oh, yeah.
100%. To use a phrase that is taken on a lot of water.
When Henry and Pella have sex, it's, like, very violent. Like, they're both going through shit.
He bruises her, too.
Yeah. A lot of bruises in this. Like, Mike punches Starblind.
Yeah. Have you ever been punched in the stomach before?
No. No interest.
I've been punched in the stomach a bunch of times, and I've never gotten a bruise on my stomach.
Well, you never got punched by Mike Schwartz.
That's true. Yeah, I never been punched in the stomach by, like, a grown-up who is, like, almost a professional athlete.
Also, I don't want to... There's no way I can say this. It's half meant as a joke, but also half meant as a way to defend the novel, and it's only going to come across as an insult, and I'm so sorry.
I'm sharpening my knives. Like, have at me, buddy, because I'm going to fuck you up.
Starblind is, like, shredded and cut and, like...
Can I show you a picture?
No, I don't want to see your stomach from, like, college.
I'm going to show you my stomach now.
No one wants to see you.
Yeah, it's like... There is.
Remember when you used to take notes before we did these podcasts?
Yeah, I listened to the first episode. It was the only episode that I've listened to, and I have, like, all this smart stuff to say about postmodernism. And now it's just like, let me show you a picture of my belly. No, you don't, like, getting punched in the stomach, you don't, that's not, you don't bruise there.
Maybe he's got a blood disorder.
Yeah, what's with the name Starblind?
It's a cool name.
It's not a real name.
No?
It doesn't sound like a real name.
Starlight, Starbright.
And there's another character named Quentin Quisp. There's a guy named Quentin Crisp, who is a, like, philosopher.
Should we talk about, I don't know if there's anything to talk about, but Henry gets to the game at the end that Affenlight is going to go to support Owen, but Affenlight is like, I can't go. This is a bad idea. I'm under investigation for this relationship. Henry should go. I'm also going to die tonight. And so he sends Henry, and Henry shows up, and then Henry, like, is the first base coach.
Yeah.
I liked that the team, like, was... He rallied around him in a way. Like, it felt real, I think. Because he's worried that they're going to hate him. They're not going to want to see him there, that he's going to be a curse to the team. He's going to bring the team down. The team is going to lose because he abandoned them and showed up at the end to sort of claim glory or whatever.
Yeah. The only person that seems mad at him is Mike.
And even Mike, or he's worried about Mike, but Mike's just like, come on, Mike, come on.
Yeah.
He waves him down too.
Because Mike says he has a strong premonition that Henry's going to show up.
Yeah.
Does it feel real?
Do you think if this was real, do you think Henry would go?
No.
And then if he did go, though, would they have welcomed him in?
Probably not. Like, that kind of a... Well, it depends. I mean, like...
He without any other way to describe it, he quit on them.
Yes. It depends if how much they know about his situation. Because it's like, if they're aware that he's suicidally depressed and hasn't eaten in weeks or a month.
Which I don't think that they would.
Mike probably knows, because you have to imagine that Pella is telling him. Or no, Pella hasn't talked to Mike in all that time. So yeah, why would they?
No.
Owen knows that he hasn't been back to the dorm. Mike knows that he's living with Pella.
But which he's probably angry at both of them for that happening.
Yeah. I don't think the team would welcome him back.
Okay.
But they don't see that. Nobody seems especially pissed at him when he leaves, except for Mike. And that's because Mike put in all this work to make him into this player. And then to have him leave after that without fixing the problem feels like more a failure of, like, Mike thinks of that as a failure of himself.
So here's the thing. The book is radically different. If Henry does not get the yips, gets drafted in the third round, the first round, whatever, he's not with Mike, or is Mike's plan to follow, because he wants to go to law school, right? Like, he's not going to follow Henry to the Cardinals or whatever. No matter how this ends, Mike's not happy.
Yeah, because he's been offered the position at Westish, and he's like, no.
Even though in the end, he says yes.
But he says yes to stay with Pella, right?
I think so. I think it's also he comes to terms with the fact that, like,
that's
his life. Have no other options, yeah.
It's what he's good at. It's what he should do. He's not a lawyer. But it's a bummer, right? Yeah. It's not what he wanted to do.
No.
So like, it is a sad ending for Mike.
The one thing I don't like about the book, like, the one thing that I can, like, I think objectively almost, like, fully say I do not like is that I think it ends too neatly. That Henry returns to the team. He and Mike are back on good terms, even though it's probably a toxic relationship. Pella has no, you know, they have, like, a farewell to Affenlight. Pella is exactly where she wants to be. Mike is with her and, you know, back with Henry. And, like, it all could crumble, like, a day after the novel ends.
Yeah.
But it ends so cleanly for everyone.
Well, also the final act, after the national championship game, after Gwert Affenlight has passed away, and after they, the other thing that we should talk about is whether or not he killed himself. After Gwert has passed away, they decide that he would have wanted to be buried in the lake. So they're going to dump his body in the lake. And there is a part where Pella brings this up to Mike, and Mike says, that sounds like something that people do in books, but not in real life.
Yeah.
And it's like, yes, exactly. That's exactly true. So why are you doing it in this book?
Right.
It feels completely fabricated, like a superficial way to wrap something up that has been mostly realistic to this point.
Yeah.
And I think that a lot of books have that problem. A lot of books have the problem of being like, we have to tie this narrative up. When it's like, you don't have to tie it up. You don't have to tie anything up.
Well, and that's your big thing. That's your big issue with, like, every book that we read. It's like, it's too neat.
Especially books that are like, you know, it was my real big problem was with Ducks, because, like, that was not a traditionally told narrative. So to end it with the traditional arc. So I have less of a problem with this. But the problem that I have with this is that they call it out. They're like, this is a traditional ending to a traditional book.
Which at the end of the day, I think it is. I think it is a traditional book. It's just like it almost fools you with the glossy veneer of, like, a cool baseball story.
Yeah. So did Affenlight, like, kill himself?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either, because he's talking about having a fucking heart attack for the last, like, 30 pages.
I think he unintentionally kills himself by, like, destructively living.
And ignoring that he has, like, these things that are clearly signs of a heart attack.
Right. That's what I mean. Like, not the destructively living in terms of, like, throwing his career into the wind by having an affair with a student. I'm saying, like, chain smoking while being like, God damn, my chest hurts.
Yeah.
Let me light up another cigarette.
And never going to see the doctor.
Right.
And even though he knows that this is a problem in his family, et cetera. But, like, at the end of the book, it really kind of presses you to think, like they want you to think that maybe he killed himself.
And that was, I didn't like that scene either. When, like, Pella gets called into the dean of the student's office or whatever, and she's just like, she's smarter than that dude, because she's, like, able to control the conversation in a way that, like, oh, so if you know about it, everybody must know. He's like, no. Just like these three or four people. Like, it's fine. The point of that conversation, he wants to know if he killed himself, and she's like, wait, what? Why? Like, that, it feels like it comes out of nowhere. Like, that's not even a thing. That's not even a thought in my mind until he, like, that character that we've never really met before is just like, but what about this?
Yeah. Also, it just seems he would never do that.
No.
Like, he's in the clear. Why would he call her in and be like, but did he? I mean, he wants to feel guilt-free about it, but I just don't.
Like, honestly, in the school's mind and that guy's mind, this is the best possible ending. I mean, you don't want a guy to die, but, like, you don't force a guy out.
Yeah.
There's no scandal.
Mm-hmm. But then he's, like, calls in the daughter and is like, so did your dad, did he kill himself? It's like, why do that?
I don't know.
It doesn't make sense. It's another, like, thing that, like, we don't need that as readers either. It doesn't add anything to the story to think that maybe he killed himself.
And again, not a thing I thought of.
Right.
Until he's just like, what if?
What else about this book? Is there anything left to talk about?
It might be corny. It might be too clean of an ending, but I got chills at the final two paragraphs where...
I don't even remember what the final two paragraphs
are. So they're on the baseball diamond. So Owen and Pella and Mike and Henry dig up Gwert's body,
mm-hmm.
and they go out in a boat and they jump into the lake, right? Pella goes off to work. Owen goes to the airport. Mike and Henry go to the baseball diamond. Henry goes to short and he's wearing Schwartz's glove. Mike's just hitting on ground balls. And he's throwing, like, it's terrible. And he throws, like, 48, 49, whatever, and he keeps missing the shovel. And then he dings one.
Yeah.
And then Mike goes, oh, there's one more. Because, like, that's the thing that's run throughout the entire thing. Like, you could always do one more.
Yeah.
Because Pella's like, when do you stop doing pull-ups? He's like, I don't know, you can always do one more. Just
you can
keep
doing it. You can have an off day, but you can never take a day off.
Right. And I just think it was, like, a really entering into the toxic relationship, but I just think it's a great, really, like, I just, like, that's a perfect ending, I think.
Yeah, this is a part that I thought was really good. It's probably about two-thirds of the way through the book. I'm going to read, it's going to be quite a bit here. All he'd ever wanted was for nothing to ever change, or for things to change only in the right ways, improving little by little, day by day, forever. It sounded crazy when you said it like that, but that was what baseball had promised him, what Westish College had promised him,
yep.
What Schwartzy had promised him. The dream of every day the same. Every day was like the day before, but a little bit better. You ran the stadium a little faster. You bench pressed a little more. You hit the ball a little harder in the cage. You watched the tape with Schwartzy afterward and gained a little insight into your swing. Your swing grew a little simpler. Everything grew simpler, little by little. You ate the same food, woke up at the same time, wore the same clothes. Hitches, bad habits, useless thoughts, whatever you didn't need slowly fell away. Whatever was simple and useful remained. You improved little by little till the day it all became perfect and stayed that way forever. He knew it sounded crazy when you put it like that, to want to be perfect, to want everything to be perfect. But now it felt like that was all he'd craved since the day he'd been born. Maybe it wasn't even baseball that he loved, but only this idea of perfection, a perfectly simple life in which every move had meaning, and baseball was just the medium through which he could make that happen. It sounded crazy, sure, but what did it mean if your deepest hope, the premise on which you'd based your whole life, sounded crazy as soon as you put it in words? It meant you were crazy.
Yeah. I love that. I highlighted that too.
That's great, because it's like, that's in a lot of ways, that's the American dream, right? This idea that you, like, your life continually becomes simple because all of the problems that you had in your past slowly move away. You need a girlfriend, you get a wife. You're married forever. You don't have those relationships. You don't have that longing and loneliness. You need a job. You need money. You get a job. You have that job until you're retired, slowly accumulating things until whatever. You rent until you buy a house, and then your housing situation is taken care of. Like, one by one, those things happen. But, like, the reality is that, like, that's not true for almost anybody. Like, all of those things are real things, but they're also things that have all their own sets of problems, and things don't get more perfect as time goes on. Things get more complicated as time goes on. They get harder to deal with. Maybe they don't get harder to deal with. I mean, the point is that it's different for every person, right? There is this idea being sold, but the selling is much more simple than the thing itself. And something that is good about sports narrative is good about this narrative, and part of what is going on with Henry is the lie that he's been sold. But one of the few places where perfection can be achieved is in sports.
You can literally throw a perfect game.
Yeah, you can throw a perfect game. There's the John Boyce Felix Biederman documentary about mixed martial arts. It goes into this huge political backstory, both on the sport itself, but on what's going on in the world around that time. And it's like, you're making more money and your money is worth less. Your college degree is worthless. The economy collapsed. There's no jobs. But, like, one thing that you can be sure is true is if you put two people in a ring and tell them to fight, the tougher person will beat the shit out of the other person.
Yeah.
You can trust in sports. So, like, that's kind of what this book is about.
Yeah.
But then it makes that more complex by saying, like, okay, but even this perfect athlete, even this, like, Terminator can short circuit.
Yeah.
Yeah. It can completely become someone who, like, is infiltrated by the pressures of the real world, whether those pressures be, like, the sudden violence of accidentally hitting your friend with a baseball. Although that's not the thing. That's not the thing that fucks Henry up. Something unknown fucks Henry up, because Henry would never throw the ball that hits Owen.
Right.
Right. So it's like, it's a complete unknown.
I think it's just the pressure. It's the fact that he's been building toward this thing, and the thing is here, and he's about to tie or eclipse his hero. And then he's, like, being told, hey, you're around the corner from superstardom and fame. And also, maybe he's afraid of being a small fish in a big pond.
Right. And around the corner from superstardom and fame is not things getting simpler. It's things getting more complex.
What I think is interesting, there's another line that I think comes shortly after that long thing, because this is after he's spiraled. Mm-hmm. And I think this is after he and Pella have sex. And it's very short. And she says, people thought becoming an adult meant that all your actions had consequences. In fact, it was just the opposite. Like, sometimes you just...
That's absolutely true.
You just do things.
But it's like something that I talk to with my students all the time, because they're like, you know, all they've been told is people won't stand for that in the quote-unquote real world. And it's just like, if you work in an office, you know what's going to happen? Is that the asshole who does no work and fucks off for 6-hour lunch breaks is going to get paid more than you.
Yep.
And like there's going to be a million excuses and that guy's going to get promoted and you're going to get fucked because the world's unfair and nothing really matters.
Yep.
That's partially not true in sports. Like sports is one of the few meritocracies that exist in the world.
Sure.
Now there are curveballs to that. You're Colin Kaepernick's
baseball
and,
joke
and more of a reference than a joke, I guess. There's your Colin Kaepernick's and all sorts of things.
That's when something supersedes into sports, right? Yeah. That's not like if it was just sports,
right?
It would not be a thing.
It's like on a perfect day, you can throw a perfect game,
yep.
and that's that. Yep. And you were the best person on that day, and yep. that's all there is to it. The perfect day doesn't really exist for office bullshit.
Nope.
Most people are just trying to get through. It's not about poetry. It's not about...
I think that's also like it's the American dream, and it's just like, you need the wife and the house and the job and the 2.5 kids and the picket fence and the dog.
Yeah.
Cool.
Although it would be freaky to have a half a kid.
Right. But now you're 35 and you have another 30 years at your job and now you've accomplished everything. So like kill yourself, I guess.
Well, yeah, I guess I'm 38 and a half. Oh, God.
All right. Let's call Matt.
He's not going to answer. He's on vacation.
Okay.
Yeah, we're podcasting is now. I know you're on vacation, but you just texted Crab Flag, so we figured we'd give you a call.
Oh, thank God, I was worried.
I'm glad you laughed there. I was worried about Joey too, and I'm here in the room with him.
Well, it sounded like you snuck out of a room to like take my call in secret.
Me? No, I'm hanging up all the shit from walking in the door.
Oh no, everything's fine. Do you want to play a game of judge a book by its cover?
Hell yeah.
And this is exciting. It's an exciting one because this is a book you've read.
Yeah, so I know. Okay. I know where we're at. The Art of Fielding.
Yeah, The Art of Fielding, Chet Harbach. It's kind of a simple cover. It's while the text comes through to you, I'm sure you have, it's a blue cover, white text, you know, appropriate for the time, even though this is going to come out after the World Series ends, kind of reminiscent of like the Atlanta Braves coloring, maybe the kind of A. But what you got here, national bestseller, New York Times Book Review, best book of the year.
Wow. Well, like we've discussed privately, I clearly don't remember anything about this book because everything that I mentioned to you guys, you said was not actually in the book.
No, it's in the book, but it's like 4 pages. You're like, the only thing I remember is he like loses his mind and goes out in the woods for 3 nights. It's like a 4-page thing in the middle of the book.
That did happen.
It did happen, good. Yeah. I just hadn't gotten there yet when you said that.
So was it a memorable sequence?
Sure, yeah. Yeah, he puts on a weighted vest and goes swimming into the middle of a lake, which is pretty scary, I guess.
Hmm. Yeah, okay. All right, let me look at this picture. Hold on.
Wonderful, a novel that is every bit as entertaining as it is affecting, says the New York Times.
The Art of Fielding. Yeah, okay, I remember this.
I personally find it striking, but I can't explain why I like it.
What I see is it looks like a hand-painted sign, and that reminds me a lot of like old-fashioned baseball stadiums that would have like old-fashioned advertisements all over the outfield.
That's cool.
So it kind of feels like that. You know, baseball, I'll be the first to tell you, has that timeless history of America quality to it that I'll wax poetic in our threads about every spring.
How can you not be romantic about baseball?
How can you not? I mean, it's easy to not be romantic about this piece of shit World Series we're about to have. I think that's what they're going for here. Has that hand painted thing? There's a little bit of like texture behind it. When did this come out? Like in 2011 or 2012?
I think before, I want to say like 2005.
I don't know. Not that long ago.
No.
I feel like I read it on my honeymoon. That had to be 2012, and I thought it was like pretty new when I read it.
Yeah, that sounds accurate. 2012, 2011.
I mean, the reason I say that is because around that time, like that was kind of like the hipster storefront boom, where like every, at least in Philly, but I feel like maybe nationwide at any of these like downtowns that were coming back on the heels of like breweries and like farm to table restaurants and stuff, everybody had a hand painted sign. Hand painted typography really had a moment there, and I feel like this is probably along that same time frame.
He came out September 2011, so you guys are right.
There you go. Yeah. I mean, not that that's not timeless anyway. Yeah, I think it was of a moment, but it holds up still. And also, The Art of Fielding is a book in the book Art of Fielding, right?
Yeah.
So maybe it's supposed to look like the book that he's reading too. So it has kind of history.
It does look a little to me like each capital letter could be the letter that you would put on a baseball cap to represent a city or a team.
Yeah.
How was your vacation?
It was great. I hadn't been to Asbury in a few years, and we went to the Silver Ball Museum, and I'd never been there. That place, here's a free plug for all your listeners. Go to the Silver Ball Museum.
Is that pinball, or what is that?
It's predominantly pinball, but they also have like old arcade games. I got to show the girls the Simpsons arcade game.
Nice.
Which God only knows how many hours and quarters I put into that over the course of my life.
It's the exact same as the X-Men arcade game and the Ninja Turtles arcade game. They're all the same game, but I love all three of them equally.
Yes, exactly. You get to pick your favorite character.
And they've gotten really into the Simpsons lately too, right? Especially Violet.
Yes, they have. So it was a nice surprise that this game was in there. I didn't want to set their expectations too high, but lo and behold, there it was.
Did you all play as a family? Like you were Bart.
Well, he would be Homer.
Lisa was presumably Lisa.
Oh, that's where you're going. Okay.
Yeah. Well, Lisa volunteered to take Felix over to the skee ball machine. So that was me.
Violet does a pretty good Marge. I gotta say, have you heard her Marge impression?
I don't think I have.
She does a great Marge. She's got that naturally raspy voice. Really puts it to use.
That's a tough voice to do. I don't think I could do a Marge impression.
She can take it down a register and do Patty and Selma as well.
Wow.
Yeah. All right. Real young Julie Kavner.
Is that because she's been smoking cigarettes or?
Yeah, we send her to the mines most days.
Violet Bouvier with her pack of cigarettes.
Yeah, she's got real bad lungs.
Right on. All right, so then what about this? Are you Astros or are you Braves?
Oh, I got to root against the Braves.
Okay,
always.
Yeah, same. So, plus, I've turned the corner, and now I like that the Astros are cheaters.
All the vitriol is coming from the fans because I think every other player on every other team knows that they fucking cheat too, and the Astros are just the team that got caught.
Yep.
Maybe they were doing it like more brazenly and like with more technology than other teams, but like not for lack of creativity on anyone else's part.
Well, the frustrating thing about them is that like they've been really good after they stopped cheating, so like they didn't need to cheat, which makes it both like less infuriating and more infuriating, right? So
or they're still cheating.
Yeah, I mean, I also carry a pretty strong like fuck teams from Texas vibe into all things anyway.
Sure.
So it's like this is as bad a matchup as you can possibly hope for. Even the champion, the league rounds, all four of those teams just horrible fan bases and there's no heroes.
Yeah, I was very, very. I don't know what the word for it is, but when I discovered that the Dodgers play "I Love LA" by Randy Newman as their victory song after every game, like that made me. It's so stupid. Like, how stupid could they possibly be?
Yeah, but you get the impression that like Randy Newman probably loves that.
Yeah, but it's just like they don't get that it's like that song is about how disgusting Los Angeles is. But I don't know. Yeah. Like, maybe they do love that. Maybe they like it. They're just like, yeah, we're scumbags.
Yeah, I doubt it. There's no way that's beyond the chorus.
All right, Matt, we need one more thing on the phone call. We need a verdict about the cover. It doesn't have to be, guilty or innocent or, you know, dismissed or whatever. What's your verdict on the cover for The Art of Fielding?
Let's say I'm trying to make, like, a baseball reference here.
Safe at home. Don't say that. That's dumb.
Yeah, safe. Let's call it high and tight.
Okay.
All right. I like it. Like my haircut. Isn't that a haircut?
Yeah,
high and tight?
Yep. That's a military haircut.
All right.
Yeah. Josh Brolin.
Thank you, Matt.
All right. Well, guys, thanks, fellas.
Have a good night.
All right. See you later, Matt.
Fantasy casting. We talked about this. This is a collaborative, but Tom Holland.
Tom Holland going from pipsqueak to kind of jacked dude and playing the difference between.
Because we were talking about this last night. You're like, who do you say is Henry? I'm like, Tom Holland. You're like, that's exactly who I thought. So like independently, we both came up with Tom Holland.
Affenlight, George Clooney, right? Probably. There are a couple other possible.
Just
examples.
An older, handsome dude.
Daniel Day-Lewis, maybe.
I said Oliphant.
Yeah, I think he might be a little young, but he seems young. Even if he's not, he seems young, you know?
53.
Yeah, but I don't just...
Born in Hawaii.
I mean, 53 is still 10 years too young for the part, right?
Clooney's 60.
Yeah.
Brad Pitt, 57.
Yeah, Brad Pitt doesn't fit because he's too, like, that's too, like, hey, that's Brad Pitt. Like, yeah. He doesn't, it's like, why is that Guess Jeans model the president of our university?
Sure.
He doesn't fit into that at all. Although I had a teacher that was
hot
when I was an undergrad. Like, he was a model. He was, like, unbelievably attractive.
What did he teach?
And he was also English literature. And he was also, he just retired this year. And he's, like, in his 60s, I think.
So now
you can Google him. Fuck it. His name's Brad Gooch.
What a name.
Yeah. He's a
American writer.
Yeah.
Nice eyes.
Like, he's an unbelievably handsome man and a great teacher.
You had an idea for Mike Schwartz. That's interesting.
Yeah, you gotta, cause I was trying to think of, like, almost every age appropriate actor is, like, some, like, CW clone.
Yep.
They all look the same. They all have the same body types. And none of those body types are, like, the hulking kind of type of a Mike Schwartz. So I think what you'd have to do is you would have to go to either a professional athlete,
mm-hmm,
or someone who is, like, a college athlete that was, like, a linebacker or something like that.
I was thinking about that because we were talking yesterday about professional athletes. I was thinking college athletes, and I don't know how that would work with, like, the NCAA. I don't know, but yeah.
You can have jobs. You just can't play sports professionally.
I guess so. Yeah, okay. Pella, I was saying, like, Anna Kendrick, but I think that is an easy part to play, like, anybody.
Yeah, mine was Olivia Cooke.
Yep. And then Owen, you got any thoughts?
I said Corey Hawkins. Corey Hawkins is, of course, like...
Dr. Dre from...
Yeah, Dr.
Compton.
And he was the cab dispatch guy in the Heights. And he was also in the King Kong movie.
We have an email address, lottery@cageclub.me, if you want to send in thoughts about this book or any book. Just, you know, again, doesn't have to be the book we're reading this time. Any book you want to email in, lottery@cageclub.me. But your friend Egg, like I read the disclaimer earlier, wrote in about The Art of Fielding. And she breaks this down by character.
Okay, sort of like we did.
Henry's just such a sweet kid. My heart broke every time anything bad happened to him. The biggest disservice Schwartz did to Henry was not to convince him, or was to not convince him, to get therapy after his throw knocked Owen in the head. When he slept with Pella, I was mainly disappointed and sad for him, but never angry or disgusted with him. Part of it could have been the fact that the narrator of the audiobook had a very sweet and innocent inflection for Henry's voice.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Schwartz might have been my favorite character in the book. Hell when yeah. He was turning down the job, I actually found myself almost praying he'd take it, even though I knew he wouldn't. The most frustrating thing about him is that he doesn't see the value of his talent for coaching in spite of it being a rare gift. He's trying to, quote, have it all instead of playing to his strengths.
Yeah, he's trying to achieve like a much more typical American dream, right? Like when we think of success, quote unquote success,
doctor,
in America.
Lawyer.
Yeah, it's doctor, lawyer, and if you fall short, and not only that, but like doctor, lawyer from an Ivy League, yeah, or a Stanford, right? And if you fall short of that, then you're not the, like, that would have completed his arc from being like orphaned Chicago tough guy to like elite. Part of me is glad that he doesn't make that transition because that transition is full of douchebags.
Yeah. He would have hated it.
You're fucking J.D. Vances and whatnot.
I don't know who that is.
You're better off.
I think he would have hated it. I think he would have gone back to Westish after... I don't even know if he would have graduated law school.
Right.
I loved Pella as a character. I think she provided a female perspective to counteract the prominent male gaze of the novel, particularly with how she sees Professor Eglantine.
Right. We didn't talk about Professor Eglantine at all, but she's like an important side character that...
Yeah, talk about Professor Eglantine.
She is made fun of a little bit by the characters who, when they're first introduced to Pella, they sort of are like, is that Professor Eglantine's girlfriend? Like she's stereotyped as a lesbian by the male characters, even though there's no real evidence that that's the case. And she is who Pella is looking for is a mother figure.
And kind of wishes that her dad would get with.
Yeah, right.
And sees her out to dinner when she goes out with David, and then her dad doesn't show up, and then Eglantine leaves, and it's just like...
Yeah, yeah.
My favorite Pella scene is the earring scene. It's taking me back... It's taking me a while to articulate why. This is what we talked about before, about the gaslighting.
Sure, yeah.
I think it's the fact that David probably spent most of the relationship gaslighting her into thinking she's crazy, then she decides to fight back in a crazy way. She took her agency back by swallowing that ear. I forgot about that.
Yeah. I did too.
By that acting like the child scene, yeah. she was before David started grooming her. And it worked.
Yeah.
Unless I'm misremembering, that's the last time we see David in the book. However, I will say the line in the scene that about girls inherently knowing how to throw up, but it got a big eye roll for me.
I was thinking about that too. Like that was kind of scary to me because I think I had the exact same reaction that David did, which is like swallowing an earring. Like what the fuck? Yeah. That's going to like really be bad for you. And then she just pukes it back up. But it's like, it's not like it's any safer puking up an earring than it is swallowing an earring.
You're go through all your digestive system, but like your trachea.
Yeah, you're still going to get snagged.
Your esophagus or whatever.
On something like that.
Doesn't Henry make himself vomit too the same way?
By jamming a finger down his throat?
I think so.
I don't remember. Maybe.
I want to say he does, but I don't remember. I think maybe because he eats and like he doesn't feel good about eating and he wants to like get it out of his system.
Yeah.
I think. I don't know.
I think Meg makes a good point though that we didn't. We talked about it a little bit because we said that like maybe the book doesn't necessarily need a female perspective. It could just be the sports stuff. But I think also like, you get this with Cormac McCarthy books too sometimes, because Cormac McCarthy doesn't really have female characters. People complain about that, but it's just like, I don't know that I necessarily want Cormac McCarthy's take on female characters, because it's like, he might be fucking terrible at it. And then we have to, and then that book is now saddled with this guy like veering off into some weird misogynist stereotyping, when it's like, if you don't do that, then it's like, that book might not have any female perspectives, but at least it's like upfront, like this is like a masculine, just that, and we don't have to. Yeah, anyway, you get what I'm saying.
Affenlight is the only character I didn't like or resonate with, but ironically, the one I would have the most to say about. I don't think it's an accident that we're shown David, the predator that groomed Pella into dropping out of high school, side by side with Affenlight, which we talked about a little bit earlier. Even though Owen's technically an adult, he's still an undergrad in a position of lower power than Affenlight. It was frustrating that for most of the book, Affenlight was going on and on about how he would not have been able to have this relationship with a female student, how it would have been inappropriate if it was a female student, but how since it's Owen, it's different. Then, when he gets caught, he starts thinking about how the school admins would not have given a shit if it was a female student, which we talked about earlier, and would have pushed it under the rug. Like, no, dude, you suck and it's wrong. So I've never seen The Social Network, but that scene in the book made me think of the quote, you're going to go through
life thinking... You've never seen The Social Network?
Come on, Egg. You're going to go through life thinking that girls don't like you because you're a nerd, and I want you to know from the bottom of my heart that that won't be true. It's because you're an asshole. Affenlight isn't punished because he's gay. He's punished because he's a predator.
Yeah, that's true.
Owen, this is how she ends her email, Owen's getting his little own subsection because he should have been one of the main characters. Instead, his entire purpose was a passive vehicle for the plot, which again is kind of true of Henry too, right?
Yeah, that, I didn't necessarily think that about Owen, but I thought that about Henry. I mean, I think that is true about Owen, but it's less of a big deal for me with Owen because Owen is like a sub character.
That dorm room just sucks all of the agency out of characters.
Yeah.
He didn't really have any agency as a character. Through him, Henry gets the yips and Affenlight has an affair, but we never see anything through his eyes, so it feels like the plot is happening to him rather than him causing any action.
Wow.
She's saying exactly what you said about Henry.
But everything that Meg thinks about Owen, I think about Henry.
The death of Affenlight seems to fix, quote-unquote, fix the other relationships in the books. It jumpstarts the forgiveness between Pella, Schwartz, and Henry, but obviously it affected Owen in a deeper way than the rest, except for maybe Pella. I guess that part of it ties to his nickname of Buddha, but he's supposed to be above everything. And then by the funeral scene that he's really not, you see that he's really not. But I still think I'd have preferred to have some scenes through Owen's eyes, which I agree with, I said earlier. Like, yeah. I think he's too prominent to not know more about him.
He doesn't have his own narrative sections at all, right?
There's
nothing where we have close third on him.
I think the closest thing we get is in the scene at the end when they're in the boat, we kind of shift perspective because they're all together. Mm-hmm.
It was at the end of the email?
It is. Thanks, Meg.
Something that I found really, really moving for some reason, and I'm not 100% sure why. It happens twice where Owen says to Henry, I think he says, you are skilled, we exhort you. And he says it to him twice, and it's just like, for some reason, that is really moving to me.
I think Owen probably loves everybody, but I think he especially, like...
He loves Henry. Yeah.
Because he's also, like, he's physically and emotional, not physically in, like, a sexual way, but, like, just, like, he lives with him. Like, he's just closer to Henry.
Yeah.
So I think his compliments to him and his, you know, interactions with him mean more because it's...
Yeah, and he is a balance to... he's the opposite end of Schwartz, right? Like, Schwartz is this intense, like, on Henry all the time, and Owen is much more, like, laid back and balanced and doesn't... Nothing gets to him.
Any other thoughts about The Art of Fielding?
I don't think I do. The path to 30,000 starts here. We're going to have 30,000 followers after this episode. That's the goal.
On Twitter?
No, not on Twitter. Fuck Twitter. Just 30,000 downloads. Unique downloads for each episode. So if you're listening to this,
Go tell 3,000 people.
Yeah, and go ahead and also write a review. Give us a 5-star review on one of those websites.
I wonder if anybody's done it, because I think only Apple Podcasts lets you actually review things. But we're on Twitter at LotteryPod, patreon.com/LotteryPod, lottery@cageclub.me, How to Win the Lottery Everywhere.
Incidentally, today's crime is Joey beating the shit out of a nerd at a concert.
Keep reading.
Someone's gotta say it, hell, I mean, things.